Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Earth, An Intimate History by Richard Fortey, narrated by Michael Page. Preface. For some years, I've been thinking about how best to describe the way in which plate tectonics has changed our perception of the Earth. The world is so vast and so various that it is evidently impossible to encompass it all within one book. Yet geology underlies everything. It founds the landscape, dictates the agriculture, determines the character of villages. Geology acts as a kind of collective unconscious for the world, a deep control beneath the oceans and continents. For the general listener, the most compelling part of geological enlightenment is discovering what geology does, how it interacts with natural history, or the story of our own culture. Most of us engage with the landscape at this intimate level. Many scientists, by contrast, are propelled by the search for the inclusive model, a general theory that will change the perception of the workings of the world. In most scientific papers, the intimacies of plants or places are hardly given a second glance. Plate tectonics has transformed the way we understand the landscape, for the world alters at the bidding of the plates. But much of the transformation has been expressed in the cool prose of the scientific treatise. The problem is how we can marry these two contrasting modes of perception, the intelligent naturalist's sensitive view of the details of the land with the geologist's abstract models of its genesis and transformation. My solution has been to visit particular places, to explore their natural and human history in an intimate way, thence to move to the deeper motor of the earth, to show how the lie of the land responds to a deeper beat, a slow and fundamental pulse. I have chosen my examples with some care, for they are all places that have figured in unscrambling this complex and richly patterned planet of ours. I have visited them all, so that the listener will also have this particular guide's reactions to the sights, sounds, smells, and ambience of the critical localities. At the same time, I have endeavored to show how knowledge of the deeper tectonic reality has changed over the last century or so. Great minds have pondered the shape of the world and have purveyed theories of everything that have come and gone. Many past theories have been founded on good reasoning for their time and place, and it would be a complacent scientist today who would claim that present knowledge is as far as it goes. Understanding advances by building upon and criticizing the work of those who went before. It is a messy and complicated business in which the human heart has as much a part to play as human intellect. This, too, is an ingredient in my story. The most difficult decisions I faced were not what to include, but what to leave out. I am acutely aware that there are areas of science that are merely sketched herein, any one of which would merit a book of its own. Geochemical cycles and their role in Earth's systems are a case in point. The antecedents of extraterrestrial events in our history is another fascinating field in which many recent advances have been made. The omission of such things in the interest of a coherent narrative was a painful necessity. What my story lacks in omniscience, I hope it makes up for in coherence and accessibility. 1. Up and down. It should be difficult to lose a mountain, but it happens all the time around the Bay of Naples. Mount Vesuvius slips in and out of view, sometimes looming, at other times barely visible above the lemon groves. In parts of Naples, all you see are lines of washing draped from the balconies of peeling tenements or hastily constructed apartment blocks. The mountain has apparently vanished. You can understand how it might be possible to live life in that city only half aware of the volcano on whose slopes your home is constructed, and whose whim might control your continued existence. As you drive eastwards from the center of the city, the packed streets give way to a chaotic patchwork of anonymous buildings, small factories, and ugly housing on three or four floors. The road traffic is relentless, yet between the buildings there are tended fields and shaded greenhouses. In early March, the almonds are in flower, delicately pink, and there are washes of bright daffodils beneath the orchard trees. You can see women gathering them for market. In the greenhouses, exotic flowers such as canna lilies can be glimpsed, or ranks of potted plants destined for the supermarket trade. Oranges and lemons are everywhere. Even the meanest corner will have one or two citrus trees fenced in and padlocked against thieves. The lemons hang down heavily, as if they were too great a burden for the thin twigs that carry them. The soil is marvelously rich. With enough water, crops would grow and grow. This was an abundant garden in Roman times, and it still is, even if crammed between scruffy apartments and scrap metal yards. Volcanic soil is rich in minerals. It is correspondingly generous to crops. Outside the city, Vesuvius is more of a continuous presence. The ground rises gently towards its brown summit. New buildings cling on to the side of the mountain, even high up among the low trees and broom bushes that clothe its flanks. The buildings are indistinct, however, hidden by a creamy yellow haze of petrochemical smog spreading outwards from the frantic centre of Naples towards the mountainside. You pass a road sign to Pompeii, but from the road there is little to distinguish this suburb from any other, for all its fame. When the road rises into the hills that abut the southern margin of the Bay of Naples, the urban sprawl begins to thin out. The orange groves are more orderly, with the trees neatly planted in rows inside cages made of makeshift wooden struts draped over the top with nets. The slopes become much steeper than on the volcanic flanks, close terraces piled one upon the other, each banked up with a wall of pale limestone blocks. Medium-sized trees with small grey-green leaves, which appear almost silvery in the afternoon light, cling to the most precipitous terraces. These are olive trees, the definitive Mediterranean survivors, oil producers and suppliers of piquant fruit. Their deep roots can seek out the narrowest cracks. They relish limestone soils, however poor they are in comparison with volcanic loam. The villages in this part of the bay are as you would expect of regular tourist Italy, with piazzas and ristorante pizzerias and youths with slick hairstyles on the lookout for a fast buck. Even this long before the summer season, there is opportunity for a smooth operator. You find yourself agreeing to hire a cab for a day for 200 euro to hug the congested roads when you could travel faster on the excellent Circumvesuviana railway for a tiny fraction of the price. Somehow, you, the visitor, have become the rich volcanic soil primed to yield a good harvest. Near the tip of the southern peninsula, Sorrento commands a wonderful prospect of Mount Vesuvius across the entire Bay of Naples. From this steep-sided town, Vesuvius looks almost the perfect gentle-sided cone. It could be a domestic version of Mount Fuji, the revered volcanic mountain in Japan. It can appear blue or grey, or occasionally stand revealed in its true brown colours. On clear days, Vesuvius is starkly outlined against a bright sky, a dark, heavy, almost oppressive presence. Or on a misty morning, its conical summit can rise above a mere sketch or impression of the lower slopes, which are obscured in vapour, as if it were cut off from the world to make a house for the gods alone. At night, ranks of lights along Neapolitan roads twinkle incessantly. Vesuvius is often no more than a dark shape against a paler but still Prussian blue sky. The lights might persuade you that the mountain was still in the process of eruption, with points of white illumination tracking lava flows running down the hillsides. From Sorrento, you can make of Vesuvius what you will, for within a day it will have remade itself. The Bay of Naples is where the science of geology started. The description of the eruption of Vesuvius and the destruction of Pompeii in AD 79 by Pliny the Younger is probably the first clear and objective description of a geological phenomenon. No dragons were invoked, no clashes between the Titans and the gods. Pliny provided observation, not speculation. Not quite 2 millennia later, in 1830, Charles Lyell was to use an illustration of columns from the so-called Temple of Serapis at Pozzuoli, north of Naples, as the frontispiece to Volume 1 of the most seminal work in geology, his Principles of Geology. This book influenced the young Charles Darwin more than any other source in his formulation of evolutionary theory. So you could say that the Bay of Naples had its part to play too in the most important biological revolution. Everybody who was anybody in the 18th and 19th centuries visited the bay and marveled at its natural and archaeological phenomena. For geology, a latecomer to the pantheon of sciences, the area is the nearest thing to holy ground that there is. If you were going to choose anywhere to retrace the growth in our understanding about how the Earth is constructed, what better place to begin? Where else more appropriate to explain first principles? The long intellectual journey that eventually led to plate tectonics started in this bite out of the western shin of Italy's boot-shaped profile. A voyage around this particular bay is a pilgrimage to the foundations of comprehension about our planet. Everything about Sorrento is rooted in the geology. The town itself is in a broad valley surrounded by limestone ranges, which flash white bluffs on the hillsides and reach the sea in nearly vertical cliffs, an incitement to dizziness for those brave enough to look straight down from the top. Seen from a distance, the roads that wind up the sides of the hills look like folded tagliatelle. Stacked blocks of the same limestone are used in the walls that underpin the terraces supporting the olive groves. In special places, there are springs that spurt out fresh, cool water from underground caverns. These sources are often flanked by niches containing the statue of a saint or of the Virgin. Water is not taken for granted in these parts. There are deep ravines through the limestone hills, probably marking where caves have collapsed. The country backing the Bay of Naples is known as Campania, and the same name, Campanian, is applied to a subdivision of geological time belonging to the Cretaceous period. If you look carefully on some of the weathered surfaces of the limestones, you will see the remains of seashells that were alive in the age of the dinosaurs. I saw some obvious clams and sea urchins belonging to extinct species emerging from the cliffs as if they were on a bas relief. A paleontologist can identify the individual fossil species and use them to calibrate the age of the rocks, since the succession of species is a measure of geological time. The implication is clear enough. In Cretaceous times, all these hilly regions were beneath a shallow, warm sea. Limey muds accumulated there as sediments and entombed the remains of the animals living on the seafloor. Time and burial hardened the muds into the tough limestones we see today. They are sedimentary rocks subsequently uplifted to become land. Earth movements then tilted them, but this is to anticipate. What one can say is that the character of the limestone hills is a product of an ancient sea. The massive limestones continue westwards onto the island of Capri, which is a 20-minute ferry ride from Sorrento and bounds the southern edge of the Bay of Naples. The island rises sheer from the sea, circumscribed by steep limestone cliffs, and your first thought is how could it support the smallest village, let alone a town? The town of Capri lies at the top of a vertiginous funicular railway running from the harbour. The buildings are ancient and quaint and, naturally enough, built of the local stone. The blocks themselves are often concealed under stucco. There is a fine medieval charterhouse where the pale limestone is put to good effect in columns supporting cloisters. Almost everything else is fabricated of limestone: walls, floors, piazzas. In the bright Mediterranean light, there is an overwhelming sense of whiteness. Some of the villas glimpsed on the hillside have the appearance of frosted cakes tucked under umbrella pines. Only dark basalt must have been imported from Vesuvius to make the surfaces of the streets. This volcanic rock is less liable to shatter than limestone. It is not difficult to imagine the racket that iron-rimmed wheels made as they clattered over these roughly matched large blocks. On the inner side of the island, there are truly astonishing vertical limestone cliffs dropping hundreds of meters to the sea. The Roman Emperor Tiberius spent his declining years in a palace on the island, the ruins of which endure. According to the prurient accounts of his chronicler Suetonius, he indulged every kind of sexual perversion in a life of epicene self-gratification. Small boys were favored. Those who displeased him were liable to be thrown off the monstrous cliffs. There is a subtle undercurrent in the Caprese atmosphere that hints at such darker things. Just offshore, there are two enormous and forbidding sea stacks, masses of limestone isolated from the main cliff by the relentless erosion of the sea. According to Norman Douglas, this was the abode of the sirens, whose alluring and fatal song Odysseus was able to resist only by being strapped to the mast of his vessel, while his muffled crew rowed onwards to safety. Capri makes you wonder whether an idyllic hilltop haven might eventually also deprave and destroy. One of the grandest villas, now a hotel, overlooking the fearsome cliffs was built by the Krupps dynasty, once the armourers of German ambitions. Unexpectedly, the builder apparently immersed himself in studying the growth of lampreys, a primitive and parasitic fish. On this island, there is a seamless continuity with the past, with Hellenic myth and Roman decadence and medieval devotion. The island gardens have seen the ages come and go, perched high upon the hardened sediments of a sea far more ancient than human frailty. There is something different about the cliffs behind the harbour in the middle of Sorrento. From afar, they have a greyish cast, a dull uniformity lacking all the brilliance of limestone. The streets career downwards towards the sea below the central piazza, following a steep-sided valley. Now you can see the rock in the valley sides. It is brownish, like spiced cake, and displays little obvious structure. Look closely and you see that embedded within it, like dates in a home bake, there are darker patches. Some are little more than wisps, others are larger, angular pieces of another rock, here nearly black, there umber brown, some including little bubbles. Then you notice that the same rock has been recruited by the local builders to construct the high walls that line the steeply sloping path, comprising blocks a few tens of centimeters across, neatly cut and used like bricks. Clearly, this rock is softer than the rough limestones that bolster the hilly vineyards and terraces. Then you notice that the same stone has been used to construct the older buildings. Down by the port, there are shops and cafes painted jolly ochre and sienna, but where the stucco has peeled, or where warehouses have simply been left undecorated, the same rock is revealed as having been used for their construction. Much of the town has grown from the identical rock that forms the steep cliffs backing the harbour. This rock is called the Campanian Ignimbrite. Its origin was a catastrophe that happened 35,000 years ago. A gigantic volcanic explosion threw out at least 100 cubic kilometres of pumice and ash. The evidence still covers an area of more than 30,000 square kilometres around the Bay of Naples, extending from Rocca Monfina in the north to Salerno in the south. The violence of this eruption would make the event that buried Pompeii seem like a small afterthought. An explosion of steam and gluey lava blew out a great hole in the earth at the edge of the Tyrrhenian Sea, not so much a bite out of Italy's profile as a huge punch. A vast cloud of incandescent material buoyed up with gas flowed like a fiery tidal wave across the limestone terrain. Lumps of volcanic rock were carried along willy-nilly in the mayhem. Destruction of vegetation was complete. When the cloud settled, in many places it was hot enough to fuse solid. The wispy remains of volcanic fragments testify to this welding. This is what makes an ignimbrite. The general term for this kind of volcaniclastic rock is tuff. This has nothing to do with tufa, which you can see encrusting the rocks around the limestone springs, even obliterating the feet of the saint in his niche, where lime is deposited. There were almost certainly Paleolithic human witnesses to this destruction, who must have thought the gods had gone berserk. The legacy of the Earth's ferocity is this apparently mundane rock that looks like cake. The angular fragments of rock within can now be seen for what they are, pieces of a destroyed volcano. It is ironic that this destruction has now been reversed into constructing buildings that are safe as houses. Naturally, nothing is safe in this uncertain world. Looking down from the limestone hills, you can imagine the hot, devastating clouds settling over where limoncello is now brewed and pizzas are spun, dumping down on the low ground as a thick, lethal blanket. These kinds of rocks were deposited from pyroclastic surges. Another eruption about 23,000 years later was marginally less devastating and did not spread so widely. It produced a different deposit known as the Tufo Galliano Napoletano, the Neapolitan yellow tuff. Rather than the color of cake, it is the color of Dijon mustard. Once you can recognize it, you spot blocks of it in many walls and buildings around Naples itself. It is almost reminiscent of the London stock bricks that make the Georgian parts of the English capital so appealing. It is there in the walls of Roman remains. Most experts believe that the volcanoes that remain to this day in the Campi Flegrei are aligned around the edge of the massive hole or caldera left behind as the legacy of this second huge eruption. The Bay of Naples itself hides most of it. It may yet blow again. It must be appropriate now to visit Mount Vesuvius. It is 1,281 meters high, not a great peak, but grand enough. Strictly speaking, only the cone itself should be called Vesuvius. The wider region, including older volcanic remnants, should be called Somma Vesuvius. To reach the mountain, go to Ercolanio station and catch the bus waiting outside in the bustling suburb. The route climbs upwards through improbably narrow streets and then out into fields planted with almonds and vines. The mountain produces a wine called Lacrimi Christi, the Tears of Christ, as evocative a name as you could wish for an indifferent Rosso. Now you can see close up the random assortment of houses that were visible only as flashes of light from the other side of the bay. They seem perilously close to the volcanic cone and unplanned, as if dropped haphazardly from the sky. Higher still, there is dense scrub, and then, looming above you, the cone itself. The bus disgorges its passengers, who must then climb to the summit along a relentless upward trail. You are following in famous footsteps, for the poets Goethe and Shelley were here before you. Nor are you ever alone. The view provides an irresistible photo opportunity for tourists of all nationalities. The conurbation of Naples stretches away below, as insubstantial as postage stamps pasted on the landscape. The dominant color is a warm brown-black. Nobody could pretend that a huge slope of clinker is aesthetically pleasing. The waste of the mountain has a curiously industrial feel, like slag from a smelter. It is easy to understand the classical notion of Vulcan's forges working away in the Earth's interior. An excellent guidebook by Drs. Kilburn and Maguire of University College London reveals that these unpromising pieces of debris are scoria and lithic fragments of the March 1944 eruption. Looking down, you can make out the edges of these latest flows in Vesuvius' long history extending beyond the base of the cone itself, like chocolate sauce sliding off a steamed pudding. By the path side, there are occasional large boulders that show black crystals the size of a fingernail. These are the pyroxene minerals that had time to crystallize out deep within the chamber of liquid rock or magma beneath the volcano. Like everything else around, these rocks are igneous in origin, formed in fire, cooled from melt derived from the Earth's depths. The crater itself is the kind of gaping hole that induces despair in those suffering from vertigo. It is 500 meters across and 300 meters deep. From the far side of the rim pass, you can just make out the amphitheatre at Pompeii, with the misty blue of the Bay of Naples beyond. It seems entirely plausible that destruction could be meted out at a distance by suitably violent explosions. The crater sides are sheer. Wisps of steam still arise from one side, like smoke from a poorly extinguished cigarette. Looking across the crater, you can readily see that it is made of piled layers of lava meters thick. You can also make out where flowing lava was replaced by explosive pyroclastic deposits, which are crumbly and easily eroded. Here is evidence for the origin of the kind of lethal clouds that wiped out Roman Herculaneum in the AD 79 eruption. The crater is not stable. Listen. There is a continuous tinkling, like ice in a glass, as pebbles fall from the sides into the interior. The volcano is temporarily quiescent, but there are many descriptions of it while awake. Here is a little of what the philosopher Bishop Berkeley had to say about it in 1717. "I saw a vast aperture full of smoke, which hindered me from seeing its depth and figure. I heard within that horrid gulf certain extraordinary sounds which seemed to proceed from the bowels of the mountain, a sort of murmuring, sighing, dashing sound, and between whiles a noise like that of thunder or cannon, with a clattering like that of tiles falling from the tops of houses into the streets. Sometimes, as the wind changed, the smoke grew thinner, discovering a very ruddy flame and the circumference of the crater streaked with red and several shades of yellow. Nowadays, handwritten labels creak in the wind. On the top of the cone, you can make out a solar-powered global positioning system. So often in Italy, there is this odd mixture of the improvised with the latest technology. Vesuvius is an irritable mountain. It has been erupting for 25,000 years or so. It will do so again. It is a classic in geological literature because several of its eruptions have been accurately described over 2,000 years. It also demonstrates many kinds of different volcanic activity, from sluggish flows that slowly and inexorably eat up landscape and houses, through ash falls that suffocate, to pyroclastic flows and surges that run faster than a racing car and engulf the plains in heat and terror. It is a volcanological casebook. After the AD 79 debacle, which killed 2,000 people and buried Herculaneum and Pompeii, there was a great eruption that began in the morning of 16 December 1631. Within a day, ash from Naples had reached Istanbul, more than 1,000 kilometers distant. This eruption killed almost twice as many people as had died at the time of the Roman Empire. The rich volcanic soil had once more encouraged the growth of a prosperous people who had spread over vulnerable areas. Massive pyroclastic flows took their toll. So did the engulfing slurries of mud and ash that flow downhill when heavy rains blend with volcanic outpourings. Ironically, the particles thrown up by a major event served to seed rain clouds in the atmosphere. Thus, in this tragedy, the four ancient elements, earth, air, fire, and water, conspired towards a common deadly destruction. Naples itself, however, was spared. There were many subsequent minor eruptions, usually about 11 years apart, all of which avoided it. An eruption is now overdue and might well be a big one. The latest 1944 eruption was studied in detail. Something like 37 million cubic meters of magma were expelled within a few days in March of that year. Much was released in the form of ash and bombs, black masses often shaped like horns or twisted loaves. There were several eruptive phases separated by periods of quiescence when the crater collapsed temporarily to block the throat of the vent. The almond blossoms everywhere shriveled on the branch. The villages of Massa and San Sebastiano were destroyed by slow-moving lava flows. The Times of London correspondent eloquently described the process. "The progress of destruction is almost maddeningly slow. There is nothing about it like the sudden wrath of devastation by bombing. The lava hit the first houses in San Sebastiano at about 2:30 a.m., but by dawn it still had not crossed the main street only 200 yards away, but was nosing its way through the vines and crushing down the small outhouses more slowly than a steamroller. For a while it seemed as if it would engulf the houses as they stood, but then, as the weight grew, a crack would appear in the wall. As it slowly widened, first one wall would fall out and then the whole house would collapse in a cloud of rubble over which the mass would gradually creep, swallowing up the debris with it. Masses of steam of slightly darker quality rose as cellars full of casks of wine exploded. Overall, one heard a steady cracking as the monster consumed hors d'oeuvre of vine stalks, olive trees, and piles of faggots stored in backyards. If it had been a pyroclastic surge, the whole thing would have been over in a second. A geologist amongst the crowds at Pompeii would probably be there to observe the effects of an ash fall that destroyed a whole city, as much as to wonder at the level of luxury enjoyed by the Roman elite. Nonetheless, the city's sheer size comes as a surprise. The discouragingly large crowds at the entrance soon disperse, and you are left to pick around at your leisure. Some of the roads allow a clear view of Vesuvius, and it is not so difficult to envisage the huge shower of hot ash that so effectively entombed this wealthy city for the archaeologists. The warning earthquakes, the great boom of an explosion, the dark cloud shooting into the atmosphere above the looming cone, the sky blotted out, wonderment turning instantly to horror as the fall began. The bodies of the inhabitants were moulded by the ashes that covered them. The most pathetic testimonies to the catastrophe are the casts that have been taken from these moulds, which are now stored at one end of a vineyard. In particular, a figure half rising from sleep, hardly stirred from private oblivion before returning to it forever, thereby preserving something of the monumentality of a sculpture, but with a vulnerability that is wholly personal. Even the stones have their own story to tell. The streets were shod with pieces of tough basalt fitted together in a coarse jigsaw. There is something peculiarly eloquent about seeing the grooves that generations of cartwheels wore into these roads. They are imprints of time itself upon what is inevitably described in the tourist blurb as a time capsule. The surfaces of the roads are lower than the sidewalks, and the curbs are marked by courses of large basalt blocks. The walls of the houses and shops and temples were often constructed of alternating courses of large blocks of ignimbrite and small sienna-coloured Roman bricks. The corners were often entirely of brick, since the larger blocks chip easily. The architects knew their local geology. In the Villa di Misteri, there was much use made of the tufo Galliano Napoletano, often built into a lozenge pattern. Originally, the surfaces along the streets would have been rendered, as they are inside the villas. But since cement was originally discovered by the Romans from grinding up tufts, so even the dressing of the buildings is geological. In the smarter buildings, the walls were painted and ornamented with figures and curlicues. Mosaic floors consisted of patterned tesserae, the common black and white ones being made of marble and basalt. Discovery of pattern books has shown that these floors could be ordered by the yard. There is a section of the hypocaust, or plumbing, on display that shows the use of lead pipes. Who knows if some of that lead could not have come from as far away as Britain, where the geological circumstances are just right for lead ores. In short, Pompeii grew from the geology, just as it was eventually consumed by it. Herculaneum was destroyed by pyroclastic flows. The inhabitants had time to attempt to flee to sea, but no time to succeed in their flight. For a small tip, a guide will let you see the skeletons of the huddled bodies down by the former harbour. The temperature must have been sufficient to kill instantly, but not to calcine the bones. Why should the outlines of the flesh at Pompeii be more affecting than these horrific accumulations of bones? It must be something to do with gesture, with individuality. All skulls smile alike. Both Pompeii and Herculaneum have geological bones. The fire has done no more than expose them. This is not only true of famous archaeological sites. Whatever the surface decoration, geological truths determine much of the reality and character of cities. The stone that builds them, the height to which towers can rise. This is a subtler connection than that with agriculture. It is more obvious that the dark, rich soils around Summer Vesuvius are the product of the weathering of old flows, and that this explains why men and women have always repopulated the area after the latest disaster. If San Gennaro, the patron saint of Naples, looks after us, Deo Gratias, we will prosper. The geology, in turn, is often related to tectonic plates, a deeper reality still, arbiter of the shape of the world. It seemed appropriate to pay our respects to San Gennaro. There is a chapel dedicated to him in the Duomo in Naples. In the 3rd century, the saint was martyred for his Christian beliefs. He was first sentenced to be torn to pieces by animals, but this was commuted to beheading. The decapitation took place at Solfatara, north of Naples, where a shrine has been erected. Some of the saint's blood was scooped up after the execution. This is still preserved as a precious relic. It supposedly has the extraordinary property of turning back into blood when it is brought out on religious occasions 3 times a year. Thus is Naples' safety guaranteed, or so the Neapolitans believe. The Duomo is reached by walking through narrow streets where squalor and splendor rub shoulders. Dark alleyways draped with washing lines and oozing suspicious liquids are cheek by jowl with churches and courtyards of decayed magnificence. The silence in the Duomo is all the more impressive for the noise and chaos outside. The saint's chapel is an ebullient confection of columns and gilt with masses of marble and serpentine, panels of onyx, busts and paintings. The saint is depicted above the right-hand altar emerging unscathed from a fiery furnace. Sanctity rises above mere volcanics. The 16th century crypt is an extravaganza of marble. The floor is constructed from marble lozenges and triangles of every imaginable hue. Yellow and pink and all manner of mottled and blotched shades framed in white. The walls have ranks of white marble niches capped by huge marble scallops and flanked by urns and flowers, drapes and putti. The whole is supported by rounded marble columns, white with gentle streaks of grey, while the ceilings sport square panels painted with the effigies of saints, angels, and bishops. A pearly marble statue of Cardinal Carata kneels on the floor, facing towards a locked bay containing San Gennaro's relic. It is like being inside a palace of spun sugar. More mundanely, the crypt serves as a reminder of the third great class of rocks besides those of sedimentary and igneous origin. These are metamorphic rocks. They may have started out as either of the other two categories, but have been altered, or even completely transformed, by heat, pressure, or by any combination of the two, when caught in the great mill of mountain building within the depths of the earth. Marble is one kind of metamorphic rock and comes in 1,000 shades, although it started out as humble limestone as plain as the cliffs of Capri. Along the Apennine spine of Italy, there are many places where heat and pressure have altered limestones in this fashion. Renaissance architects made luscious use of these rocks. They can appear to resemble anything from blue cheese to slices of liver, or they can be pure white, like the Carrara marble favored by great sculptors such as Michelangelo. Naples was just following the fashion. San Gennaro's niche is clad in the products of the infernal heat to which he is now impervious. Early visitors to the Roman antiquities of the Bay of Naples were following the tradition of the Grand Tour, a cultural perambulation around Italy made by young gentlemen with pretensions to enlightenment. 18th century English aristocrats would have been as familiar with the classics, with the writings of Virgil and Horace, as they would have been with the salty, homegrown vigour of Chaucer or the sonnets of Shakespeare. they would have known about the hot springs that supplied the baths in which Roman gentry lounged for the good of their health. They would have been familiar with the ambulatoria along which the pampered rich strolled with their favourite philosophers for the good of their minds. The archaeology of the area was the latest sensation. Sir William Hamilton is known now mostly for his marriage to Lord Nelson's mistress, but he was a considerable archaeologist and antiquarian and the purchaser of treasures that still grace the collections of the British Museum. He also appreciated the uniqueness of the Neapolitan landscape and strove to make known its volcanic features. While he was British envoy in Naples towards the end of the 18th century, he published a book about the Phlegrean fields, Campi Phlegrei, which well described the area to which he was devoted. Perhaps it is this for which he should be remembered. Certainly his work was known to the young Charles Lyell. Lyell had travelled to Italy in 1828 in the company of Sir Roderick Murchison, who was then the most influential British exponent of the young science of geology. If classic areas are made so by the observations of perceptive eyes and measured by the hard currency of influence on subsequent thought, then there is a claim to be made for this modest Roman site in the middle of the town of Pozzuoli, west of Naples. But no plaque records it, no signs direct you to it. You simply come across it, as you might a standing stone in England or a roadside shrine in Italy. The Phlegrean Fields. The very name sounds like some version of Arcadia. It is, in fact, derived from Greek for burning. I had seen Sir William Hamilton's portrayals of the scenery, trees giving on to a rustic scene, the odd peasant going about his business, in the distance some interesting volcanic phenomenon in progress. This was the area of Campania described by the 2nd century historian Florus as the most beautiful region not only in Italy but also in the world. Nothing is sweeter than its climate. To say everything, spring flowers twice there. Nothing is richer than its soil. Nothing is more hospitable than the sea. Times do change, of course, and the region has been swamped by undistinguished suburbs, but the Campi Phlegrei is still the same collection of craters and calderas separated by volcanic hills as it was in Florus' time. Only the flat bottoms of the former have often been filled in with army barracks or cheap industrial units. The reality of these evocatively named fields are sadly something of a disappointment. Lake Averno was considered to be one of the entrances to the underworld in classical times. In those days, birds roosting around it were wont to fall dead from the trees. From here, Dante was led by Virgil into the Purgatorio. If geology is the true underworld, then Lake Averno seemed to provide a kind of metaphorical entry point to the deep regions that form the subject of this book. Can you imagine anywhere with richer associations? It is an almost perfectly circular crater lake, three quarters surrounded by steep walls of tuff. When I visited in early spring, it had a slightly sinister character. Plumes of smoke arose, not from volcanic exhalations, but from burning heaps of rubbish left over from the last summer season. A few mean reeds grew from the lake bottom, and bubbles of gas arose and broke the surface. Methane, I suppose, from the deoxygenated mud. Perhaps, after all, this is a postmodern underworld with existential gloom presiding. There is a geological explanation for this lethal lake. After volcanic eruptions have subsided, invisible eruptions of gas may continue. Carbon dioxide is one of them. It is odorless and heavy, much heavier than air, so it sits around invisibly or flows into pockets and depressions. It induces suffocation. Until a century ago, a cave with these properties in another crater in the Campi Phlegrei, Astroni, was shown to visitors as a tourist attraction. It was called Grotto del Cane, Cave of the Dog, for reasons which will become apparent. The playwright and jobbing writer Oliver Goldsmith reported in 1774 on this grisly natural phenomenon in an History of the Earth and Animated Nature. This grotto, which has so much employed the attention of travellers, lies within 4 miles of Naples, and is situated near a large lake of clear and wholesome water. Nothing can exceed the beauty of the landscape which this lake affords, being surrounded by hills covered with forests of the most beautiful verdure, and the whole bearing a kind of amphitheatrical appearance. However, this region, beautiful as it appears, is almost entirely uninhabited, the few peasants that necessity compels to reside there looking quite consumptive and ghastly from the poisonous exhalations that arise from the earth. The famous grotto lies on the side of a hill, near which place a peasant resides who keeps a number of dogs for the purpose of showing the experiment to the curious. These poor animals always seem perfectly sensible of the approach of a stranger and endeavour to get out of the way. However, their attempts being perceived, they are taken and brought to the grotto, the noxious effects of which they have so frequently experienced. Upon entering this place, which is a little cave, or hole rather, dug into the hill, about 8 feet high and 12 feet long, the observer can see no visible mark of its pestilential vapour. Only to about a foot from the bottom, the wall seems to be tinged with a colour resembling that which is given by stagnant waters. When the dog, this poor philosophical martyr, as some have called him, is held above this mark, he does not seem to feel the smallest inconvenience, but when his head is thrust down lower, he struggles to get free for a little, but in the space of 4 or 5 minutes he seems to lose all sensation and is taken out seemingly without life. Being plunged into the neighbouring lake, he quickly recovers and is permitted to run home, seemingly without the smallest injury. It is the recovery of the dogs from their ordeal that identifies the gas as carbon dioxide. Goldsmith goes on to say that the vapour is of the humid kind as it extinguishes a torch, an experiment still performed in school laboratories to this day. Had the gas been sulphur dioxide or hydrogen sulphide, the poor dogs would have suffered a rapid and painful death. In 1750, a statue of the god Serapis was excavated from a Roman site at the coastal town of Pozzuoli. Serapis was based ultimately upon the Egyptian god Osiris, but hybridized with Greco-Roman gods to become the basis of a widespread cult in the Mediterranean at the time of the Emperor Hadrian. For more than a century and a half, the impressive archaeological discoveries in Pozzuoli were known as the Temple of Serapis, or the Serapion, under the belief that the statue indicated a sacred function. This is the name that appears in the caption to the illustration that forms the frontispiece of Charles Lyell's Principles of Geology. The image is also engraved on the Lyell Medal of the Geological Society of London, so it clearly mattered to his contemporaries. The current perception is that the temple is nothing of the sort, but was in truth a rather opulent marketplace or macellum. But it is still a geological shrine, an emblem for the coming of age of geology as a science. It is something of a disappointment that it had to be deconsecrated. After all, the temple is a holy place for rationalists, if that is not an oxymoron. At first sight, the Serapion is curiously unimpressive. The old town of Pozzuoli lies on a hill and has been out of bounds since the earthquake crisis of 1982. The site lies near the harbour beyond the hill. A few yards seawards from the ancient mart, there is still a market selling oranges and lemons and local fish. Then you see the old marketplace lying beyond a well-shaded square. It lies about 6 metres below the level of the present piazza. It is like looking down into a sports field or a football pitch, a resemblance increased at night when the area is floodlit. The large rectangle is dominated by 3 huge columns, which a notice tells us are 12.5 metres high and composed of a single piece of marble. They must have been expensive items even at the time the market was built. In front of them, there is a raised circle carrying a series of smaller columns that were probably reconstructed relatively recently, whereas the great columns were in place. The circle is constructed of the familiar tuff, underlain by courses of Roman bricks. There are planted palm trees whose trunks supply a kind of biological equivalent to the marble columns. All around the edge of the market square are remains of the stalls of the traders. The monument has none of Pompeii's breathtaking qualities, tucked away as it is so matter-of-factly in the middle of Pozzuoli. The casual observer might wonder at its importance. To discover the reason requires closer examination of the great columns. About 4 meters above their pedestals, there are what look from a distance to be zones of blackish discoloration, where the marble appears roughened or eroded. The lower parts of the columns are, as Lyle said, smooth and uninjured. Look more closely at the discolored parts of the columns. You can now see that the marble has been perforated and pierced. Identical borings are caused by the marine clams that Lyle knew as lithodomus. They can be found around the Bay of Naples today. The great Swedish biologist Linnaeus had originally named the destructive species Lithophaga lithophaga, a name that tells you all you need to know. For lithophaga means rock-eater in Greek, which is exactly what these clams do. They bore into rocks at the watermark, eventually reducing the host limestone to a kind of framework. The implication should be clear, just as it was to Charles Lyell. The columns were, of course, constructed above the sea, but the whole marketplace must then have been immersed beneath the sea sufficiently to drown the lower part of the columns. Not only that, the whole marketplace must have been raised again for the visiting archaeologist to inspect the borings. It was possible to infer further details. The rock eaters operate only in clear water, so it seems that the lower parts of the columns must have been buried beneath sediment in order to remain so clean. The borings total almost 3 meters of the columns. Thus, the immersion and subsequent elevation must have been greater than 6 meters and could well have been more. Lyell was tempted to associate the depression of the temple with an eruption at Solfatara nearby in 1198, and its subsequent elevation with the eruption of Europe's youngest mountain, the small volcano of Monte Nuovo, which appeared almost overnight on the outskirts of Pozzuoli in 1538. I went there. Although so juvenile, it is already weathering away to rich soil. Thus, the interpretation of these past events was made, rationally, by reference to what could still be observed at the present time. The clams had not changed their habits. The world had gone up and down, or rather down and up, but this was not catastrophic. The street markets still plied their many trades. The same physics that had operated in past years operated again today. This statement seems almost banal now, but it provides the basis for all modern geological reasoning. There has been much puffy stuff written about whether or not Lyell's uniformitarianism permitted variations in intensity of causes, or whether he applied his logic in a consistent way, and whether he assumed indefinite stretches of geological time. And there is a good case for making the Edinburgh geologist James Hutton, 1726 to 1797, the true father of the modern geological method. For most geologists, though, the important fact is that Lyell provided a clear way of thinking about the world. He substituted a rational system of investigation based upon present processes for a belief in a series of catastrophes, the latest of which was the biblical flood, according to some. A marvelous cartoon by Henry de la Beche, first director of the Geological Survey of Great Britain and Ireland, shows the light of science dispelling the darkness which covered the world. The light in question that dispels the clouds covering the globe is carried by a female figure who also bears in her right hand a geological hammer, for this was the particular discipline that was seen as attacking reactionary thinking by main force. The Lyellian method still lies behind everything described in this book. Look at volcanoes today to understand volcanoes in the past. Do experiments in the laboratory to understand what goes on at depths in the earth. Look at what plates do at the present time to understand how the world was made. Stephen Jay Gould has pointed out that the Temple of Serapis was a much more appropriate symbol for the Lyellian method than temperamental Mount Vesuvius. Gould remarks in Lyell's Pillars of Wisdom, 1986, that Lyell presented the three pillars of Pozzuoli as a triumphant icon for both key postulates of his uniformitarianism, the efficacy of modern causes and the relative constancy of their magnitude through time. Scientists now tend to downplay the second part of this thesis, because they know that the Earth has evolved and changed from its origins more than 4 billion years ago. Not every process has continued at exactly the same pace at all times. There have, on occasion, even been catastrophes. But the principle of reconstructing the past by using present-day analogues has remained at the center of the process of turning geology from a pastime for dilettantes into a science. I could not have said what I have said about the ignimbrite of Sorrento or the limestones of Capri without Lyell's example. Put simply, Pozzuoli made a difference to science. Charles Babbage should be mentioned at this point in the story. Born in 1792, Babbage was a brilliant mathematician, known today as the originator of computing and the inventor of the calculating machine. He, too, visited the Serapion in 1828, 2 years before the publication of the first part of Lyell's Principles. He presented a paper on his very detailed computations on the site at the Geological Society of London on 12 March 1834, and it is a model of Lyellian reasoning. It was not published until 1847 as a postponed paper in Volume 3 of the Quarterly Journal of the Geological Society of London. The editor included the intriguing note that the paper, by the request of author, was returned to him soon after it was read, and has been in his possession ever since. One wonders what sort of inhibition caused Babbage to delay nearly 20 years before printing observations that would have placed him at the start of uniformitarian reasoning. By 1847, the scientific zeitgeist had already changed. However, you cannot but admire Babbage's summary. In reflecting on the causes which produced the changes of level of the ground in the neighborhood of Pozzuoli, I was led to consider whether they might not be extended to other instances, and whether there are not other natural causes constantly exerting their influence, which, concurring with the known properties of matter, must necessarily produce alterations of sea and land, those elevations of continents and mountains, and those vast cycles of which geology gives such incontrovertible proof. From Pozzuoli to the world. In this brief summary, Babbage encapsulated much of the research program undertaken by modern geology. This book is about explaining the character of the Earth. The ultimate controls on the personality of the planet are tectonic plates. They are the natural causes, constantly exerting their influence, of which Babbage wrote. So my story will inevitably lead to an outline of plate tectonics. But I shall get there through special and particular places, like the Bay of Naples, where geology and history are interwoven. I shall explore the influence of geology on the character of landscape and the character of people. Far from being the driest of the sciences, geology informs almost everything on our planet and is rich with human entanglements. The rocks beneath us are like an unconscious mind beneath the face of the earth, determining its shifts in mood and physiognomy. The progress of our understanding is also inextricably linked with the virtues and failings of the investigators. Different eyes at different times looked at the same view across the Bay of Naples and saw different things. One perhaps saw the wrath of the gods, another relief of pressure from a magma chamber. Textbooks tend to fill it out, the history and scenery, in order to give the current scientific consensus, so this is a kind of anti-textbook. In truth, the same classical areas have seen a half dozen different generations of scientists tapping the rocks or putting their instruments about. But I shall try my best to avoid what the historian James Secord terms the Whiggish view of history, by which you uncover the mistakes of your forebears in the progress towards present enlightenment. Understanding is always a journey, never a destination. If you try to comprehend how thought has changed over a century or more, there are a few books that can act as useful benchmarks. Since Lyell, there has been a handful of authors who have comprehensively summarized the knowledge of their time, who have tried to write down the world on paper. One of those was the Austrian geologist Eduard Zeuss, 1831 to 1914, whose Das Antlitz der Erde, published in four massive volumes between 1883 and 1904, is probably the most ambitious attempt ever to capture the entirety of everything. You feel that a fact foolish enough to escape Zeuss' grasp probably was not worth his notice. Zeuss sat in Vienna like an omnivorous spider with a web spread over the world, tugging in facts. Das Antlitz der Erde was translated into English as The Face of the Earth by Herta Zolas, the wife of an eccentric Oxford professor of geology, and published in 1904 to 1909. If you want a view of what geological knowledge was like at the end of the 19th century, when geologists using the scientific method had already scanned much of the world, then Zeuss is your best guide. He, too, wrote of the Bay of Naples and of the Temple of Serapis, noting that on Capri there are lithophaga borings as much as 200 meters above present sea level. He had insights that are still woven into the fabric of geological thought, and even where we now know he was mistaken, it is instructive to try to understand why he thought what he did. Yesterday's cast-iron inference is often today's discarded argument. As Mott Green has pointed out in Geology in the 19th Century, Zeuss differed fundamentally from Lyell in believing that, far from operating in a kind of steady state, the history of the Earth was punctuated by periods of pronounced change, revolutions during which mountain belts were thrown up, for example. We shall hear that this tension between continuity and sudden change was resolved only when the plate tectonic view was established. In 1944, 40 years after the last volume of Zeuss' magnum opus was published, another widely influential work appeared, Principles of Physical Geology by Arthur Holmes. Known to generations of students simply as Holmes, it was a tremendously successful textbook from the outset, for two reasons. It was well and clearly written, and it was illustrated throughout with photographs. Holmes was a professor at the universities of Durham and Edinburgh, and in some ways a more radical figure than Zeuss. Cherry Lewis has recently written the first biography of him. Holmes did not try to write out the whole world in longhand like Zeuss, but sought to illustrate geological principles by selected examples, which could come from anywhere appropriate around the globe. It was a successful formula and will do well as a record of mid-20th century views of how geology makes the world what it is. My own intention is much more modest, since I have no pretensions towards the omniscience of Zeuss nor to the didactic skills of Holmes. The few places I describe in detail, many of which I have visited, show what geology does to the landscape and its history, or the kinds of animals and plants that flourish there. The intention is selectively to illuminate rather than to be comprehensive. Arthur Holmes is relevant for another reason, at the point we have reached in the journey around the Bay of Naples. He was a pioneer in methods of radiometric dating of rocks. This is vital to the narrative of the Earth. Lyell may have provided the intellectual tools for understanding geological processes, but he did not provide a time scale. The span of geological time was a mystery, and contemporary estimates of the age of the Earth varied wildly, from a few to many millions of years. There were even those who still adhered to the calculations of James Usher, 1581 to 1656, Archbishop of Armagh, which placed the date of creation in the year 4004 BC. However, most scientists agreed that the Earth had to be old to accommodate all the rocks in their various sequences, all those Lyellian events. But how old? Leading 20th century physicists, notably Sir Harold Jeffreys, made estimates based upon good physics but false assumptions, such as the presumptive cooling rate of the Earth. Such estimates invariably proved too young, but were vigorously defended for decades. The development of radioactive clocks has served to put an objective date on remote antiquity. The method is based on the natural rate of decay of the radioactive isotopes of certain elements, such as uranium, carbon, and potassium. These rates can be determined experimentally. For example, 235 uranium decays very slowly over hundreds of millions of years to 207 lead. Hence, if you measure the amount of decayed product, you have a measure of time elapsed. It's as simple as that, though many complexities arise along with accuracy of measurement. Holmes's working lifetime spanned an era of technical improvements, which continue today, and estimates of the age of the Earth steadily increased and became more accurate as methods were refined and older rocks were discovered in the field. After Holmes's death, dating of moon rocks and solar system meteorites finally nailed the time of the origin of the Earth as 4.5 billion years ago. These refinements of dating techniques allowed for calculation of the rates of change of what Babbage had called the vast cycles of geology. The speed at which plates move, the time taken to erode a mountain range, the length of time of an eruptive phase, how long dinosaurs were in charge of the land. Because different radioactive elements decay at varying rates, techniques must be tailored to the problem at hand. Thus, 14 carbon decays very fast and can only be used to date comparatively recent events up to about 30,000 years ago. I have a scientific paper before me that uses radiocarbon dates extracted from the same kinds of clams that bored into the Serapion's columns to show that on the island of Ischia there has been 70 meters of uplift in 8,500 years. So there are clocks for the world, completing the task that Lyell started. It has become almost a cliché that we cannot grasp the immensity of geological time, what 5, 50 or 500 million years actually means. But around Pozzuoli, the changes we observe have taken place over thousands rather than millions of years. Luciano Bagnoli has been compelled to move the mooring of his fishing boat nearly a meter lower since his father's time, such is the rate of uplift in Pozzuoli. You do not have to travel very far if you want to see evidence for the forces that are lifting the whole region from the sea. The Solfatara crater lies just on the edge of town. You smell it before you see it, the result of what Oliver Goldsmith would have called its noxious emanations and pestilential vapors. It is still hissing furiously. Courses of angular boulders line the rim of the volcano, the remains of its last explosive phase, resulting in a volcanic breccia. Half of the crater floor is devoid of vegetation and as active volcanically as you could wish. There are numerous fumaroles belching forth steam. Holmes calls these active vents solfataras, so evidently we are at the type locality for this kind of thing. The Bocca Grande is the largest of them all, a roaring vent that emits steam at a temperature of 160 degrees centigrade. It sounds like a perpetually boiling kettle of enormous size, or the gasping of some great steam engine. It has been carrying on like this for years and years. A volcanologist called Friedlander built a hut almost adjacent to it, the better to monitor its exhalations. Such is scientific obsession. The ancients called the area around the Bocca Grande the Forum Vulcani, and you do feel that the earth is manufacturing or forging something deep beneath your feet. What actually comes out are sulfides. The stink in the air is hydrogen sulfide, the smell of rotten eggs. There are smears of reddish-yellow color around the lips of the vents. These are condensed patches of rare minerals, compounds of arsenic and mercury with sulfur, with names like realgar, orpiment, and cinnabar that would have been familiar to alchemists 5 centuries ago. This is indeed where the alchemy of the earth distills precious elements upon the ground. Most of them are also very toxic. They were the preferred materials of 19th-century poisoners. In 1700, a high tower was built to collect condensate from the steam, and particularly for alum, which is used as a mordant in the dyeing industry. It no longer stands. This steamy natural cauldron is a place where chemistry happens in the open air. Around some of the hot holes thrive heat-loving bacteria that have probably endured on Earth for as much as 4 billion years. Elsewhere, the ground is pitted and fuming as if a bomb had recently been dropped. In the center of the crater, a mud volcano is still spitting. There is also the famous stufae, two ancient brick-lined grottos excavated into the side of the mountain. They were once used as sweating rooms, sudatoria. Since classical times, this has been one of the alleged health benefits of the Campi Flegrei. One room was known as purgatory, 60 degrees centigrade, and the other as hell, 90 degrees centigrade. I sat in the steam inside the entrance to purgatory for a few seconds, but had to crouch because it was just too hot near the ceiling. Sulfur and alum were crystallizing on the brickwork. Within a few seconds, the swelter became insufferable. In a word, purgatory. All these steamy phenomena are the result of a magma chamber hidden beneath the Pozzuoli area. Groundwater percolating downwards becomes superheated and then blasts upwards, carrying with it mineral exhalations from the depths. The volcano is literally letting off steam. Current estimates are that the magma chamber is 2 kilometers below the surface and rising. Some volcanologists are deeply worried that the Campi Flegrei, rather than Vesuvius, where the magma is at about 5 kilometers deep, may be about to explode, and that the Monte Nuovo eruption of 1538 might have been no more than a preamble. If so, the prospect is terrifying. If there were an eruption rapidly followed by a pyroclastic flow, the effects would be overwhelming. The chaos of the roads is bad enough on a fine spring afternoon, and speedy evacuation of thousands of people would be an impossibility. Hidden forces may yet take vengeance on lax town planners and profiteering builders in a drastic and unpredictable way. It is conceivable that the Temple of Serapis could be interred beneath a pyroclastic tuff and once more consigned to archaeological oblivion. There were earthquakes in 1982 to 1984 that were sufficiently worrying to prompt the evacuation and abandonment of part of the old town of Pozzuoli. A seismic hazard map published by the Osservatorio Vesuviano shows an area with maximum observed values of seismic energy released and intensity centered on Pozzuoli, and concentric zones of destruction all around. The magmatic masses are moving at shallow depths in the western part of the Gulf of Pozzuoli. The successor to the Neapolitan yellow tuff may yet be brewing unseen. You would never guess it from the insouciant joshing of the customers in the bars near the litter-strewn beach in Pozzuoli, even though the evidence of past volcanic fury lies in the rocks exposed all along the shore. The problem lies in predicting when disaster might happen. It could be many years away, but it might be much sooner. This is the paradoxical nature of risk. Earthquake shocks of a particular kind should provide a signal, but you cannot live every day expecting it to be your last. By now, it will be scarcely surprising to learn that attempts at scientific prediction of eruptions also had their origin around the Bay of Naples. The observatory was founded on Vesuvius in 1841, making it the oldest of its kind in the world. The scientific office has now moved to Ercolano, where electronic monitoring can be collated at a distance, but the older, more elegant building remains on the flanks of the volcano and houses a museum, including some of the original instruments. The very first seismograph was made by Ascanio Filomarino, and there it is. It is a wonderfully simple contraption comprising an iron pendulum 2.6 meters long with a suspended weight of 2.5 kilograms, to which is attached a pencil that draws on a scroll of paper below. When the world shook, it moved. Charmingly, there are some little bells attached to the weight, presumably so that the natural philosopher might be awakened from his slumbers if a tremor happened along. But the virtuoso had a very clear idea of what he expected of his instrument. Writing about his invention in 1797, Filo Marino observed that in the towns and villages near the volcano, use can be made of it together with an atmospheric electrometer, and observing them together with the several signs of the volcano, one can sometimes, if not foresee clearly some new eruption, at least conjecture it. No modern volcanologist could have put it better. For 200 years, the business has been trying to predict when a volcano will blow. But even with the most sensitive seismometers and with the help of computers of great power, it is still possible to be caught unawares by Vulcan in retributive mood. Ascanio Filomarino would have been delighted by the measurements that are now routinely taken around the Campi Flegrei. At the edge of the Solfatara crater, I spotted another one of the solar-powered instruments that were on Vesuvius. Thanks to refinements in the global positioning satellites, the smallest heaves in the surface of the ground can now be measured. These systems are now so sensitive that it is possible to detect the depression of the surface of the Earth produced by heavy snowfalls, as has been demonstrated by experiments in Japan. Far from being stable, the Earth seems to pulse irregularly in ways we could never have imagined. For the Bay of Naples, the Argo project is a network for Italian geochemical and seismic observations. The communications company Telespazio has set up a network to control seismic risk for the Ministry of Civil Defense, enabling seismic and geochemical data to be transmitted to a stationary satellite. Around Solfatara, there is a main outpost and two secondary outposts. The latter are powered by solar panels and have electronic sensors to measure any seismic activity, as well as changes in gaseous composition around the crater that might indicate a change in the magma chamber beneath. The data are transmitted to the main outpost and thence by way of a parabolic antenna to the stationary satellite. This information is then available to research stations around the world. In theory, it should be possible to recognize the potential for an eruption far sooner than has ever been feasible in the past. A sudden acceleration in the inflation of the ground, changes in gas emitted from fumaroles, or a juddery earthquake of the harmonic type all might indicate an impending crisis. The most difficult problem will be making the local population take the warning seriously. The story of geology has been one of letting go of permanence. From a world created just as it should be by God, we now have a world in flux. Volcanic eruptions may have once been considered a punishment for the sins of mankind, but they were not necessarily the symptom of a mutable world. If the Temple of Serapis demonstrated up and down movements beyond question, then it was only a beginning. It was evident in Pozzuoli that the land, rather than the sea, had changed level. But as the geological record was investigated elsewhere, it soon became clear that there were other times in other places when the sea was high relative to the land, as when it spilled over onto continents to leave a record of sedimentary rocks deep in their interiors. During the Cretaceous, when the white cliffs of Capri were laid down beneath the sea, there were similar sediments being laid down far and wide across the world, most familiar to the English in the White Cliffs of Dover. Zeus had recognized these transgressions of the sea. Fossils of a single species could be found in many localities, which enabled timelines to be cast across continents. The distributions of land and sea as they are today are just in passing, moments in the slow march of geological change. Former sediments could be raised high to provide places where the silky white villas of the Caprese rich enjoy a temporary vantage point, but destined to be reduced again to sea level by the slow, inexorable mills of erosion. How much more extraordinary still to contemplate the Earth wholly in motion. Nothing seems to be at rest. The surface of the Earth dilates and collapses. The seas rise and fall. Further, the very continents move. Suetonius would have dismissed me as a madman had I pointed out to him that Vesuvius is a consequence, ultimately, of Africa moving bodily northwards. But Africa really is on the move. The floor of the Mediterranean Sea is a collage of tectonic plates. Ultimately, that sea is doomed to obliteration when the main body of Africa ploughs into the European mainland in 30 million years or so. But now the sea exists in an awkward accommodation, as the saying has it, between a rock and a hard place. The northern edge of the African plate is plunging downwards beneath the southern tip of Italy, which allows the infinitely slow oceanic contraction to continue. Italy is twisted and swiveled in the process. The energy released deforms rocks to marble and uplifts the limestone hills. A whole series of Italian volcanoes are engaged in this congress of plates. Stromboli, with its continuous grumbling eruptions, Etna on Sicily, which has erupted recently and dramatically, Vulcano, the home of Vulcan himself, and the eponymous epitome of a volcano, and more than 20 others with less familiar names spanning much of the length of Italy and scattered through the Aeolian waters. The story of how these volcanoes relate to the movement of tectonic plates is a complicated one, and geologists do not agree on the details. However, all specialists seem to concur that the region behind the African collision zone has rotated anticlockwise. Rending of the Earth's crust produced the Tyrrhenian Basin here 8 million years ago. The volcanoes were related to fracture zones that accommodated this convulsion in the skin of the Earth. They are like sticky blood oozing from deep wounds where the Earth's crust thinned. The jostling of the plates results in fractures in the crust, faults, movement along which caused earthquakes and tremors. The uplift and tilting of strata are the testimony to this activity. Ultimately, the energy needed to produce lava derives from the crunching drive of Africa northwards into Europe. As crust plunged downwards, it partly melted, creating the magma which ultimately fed volcanoes. Lavas rich in the element potassium still retain a signature that proves that a proportion of melted continental crust must have been mixed up with oceanic crust. This magma recipe also conditions the fluid properties of the lava during eruption. At some times, it flows in an almost docile, if relentless, fashion. At others, mixed with gas and water, it explodes in a series of devastating pyroclastic flows. Everything around the Bay of Naples is controlled by the movements and interactions of tectonic plates kilometers below the surface. The seen is under the control of the unseen. The surface is at the behest of the underworld. Exploring such connections is the theme of this book. Even the most apparently ephemeral of Earth's memorials are a reflection of a deeper reality. What could be more superficial than man's concern with his appearance, with cosmetics, the paint on the surface, that attempt to plaster over his own mortality? What could be more trivial by comparison with geological reality? The town of Baia on the western side of the Bay of Naples was born out of hedonism and beauty treatments. The hot springs there fed Roman baths of unrivaled luxury. There are still ghosts of paintings on the ceilings of the rooms where the rich went to cool off or heat up and giggle at the latest gossip or discuss the hottest scandal of the first century. What modern-day Italians call the bella figura was just as important nearly 2,000 years ago. The baths were fed from springs that were plumbed down into a tectonic reality that cared nothing for the carnal scandals of a two-legged ape that had only moved out of Africa a few thousand years ago. These springs were the exhalations of the magmatic unconscious. Yet Baia and the Pozzuoli coast invented the concept of the holiday, time out in luxury to tickle the palate or the fancy. According to contemporary sources, the slopes of the bay were lined with marble palaces and walkways furnished with columns and with cool fountains for reflection and dalliances. Edward Zeus was disapproving. It was in the flowery fields of Puteoli, Baiae, and Misenum that under the empire at the expense of a subjugated world, the most sumptuous festivals were celebrated. This area was like Nice on the French Riviera in the days of the English aristocracy, or the Big Sur coast of California in the days of the Hollywood glamocracy, except that it was on a scale altogether more grandiose. you can still get some impression of the vanished splendor and luxury, for bio remains, although the plaster has mostly fallen off the walls and the paintings have often faded. The hillside where the stylish Romans strolled after their bath is still there, but it now has the atmosphere of a terraced provincial park gone to seed. The view across the Bay of Naples remains splendid, and with a little effort it is possible to imagine a continuous stretch of villas lining the bay. Close up, however, all is decay. Even the diamond pattern of the yellow tough bricks, the opus reticulatum that built the walls, shows mortar standing proud of the weathered bricks it supports, for the rocks produced by violent eruption do not necessarily make strong building stones. The earth movements in this area have submerged the ancient waterfront so that it now lies more than 400 meters from the present shoreline. Part of the drowned city is still visible in the clear water. The thermal springs no longer bubble up in the ancient baths since the tectonic wellsprings have moved on. You can still have a thermal bath on the island of Ischia, which lies off the northwestern edge of the Bay of Naples and where the springs are alive and pumping. A doctor there will advise you on which particular elixir you need for your aches and pains, but fashion and geological plumbing have deserted Baia. The western end of the Bay of Naples is the Capo Miseno. It is now a deserted spot, although it was once a great naval base for the empire and housed perhaps 10,000 sailors. Only scattered foundations and remains of columns attest to its former greatness. From here, you can look back across the Bay of Naples towards Vesuvius, with the Sorrento coast beyond, where this chapter began. It is a good place to reflect on historical and geological time and the forces that have shaped everything in prospect. The bay itself, the craters around the Campi Flegrei, even the distant hills. This was the spot where geology could be said to have begun when Pliny the Younger, as a youth of 18 in AD 79, observed from a safe distance the eruption of Vesuvius that obliterated Pompeii. His uncle, the elder Pliny, died in the eruption. The latter's natural history was a cornerstone of natural philosophy for more than 1,000 years, so it would not be too much of an exaggeration to say that the future of all science was engaged with the magma chamber of one temperamental mountain. The younger Pliny described the cloud that proved his uncle's nemesis as resembling one of the umbrella pines or Italian stone pines that still provide welcome shade around the villas dotted about the bay. The volcanic cloud shot up to a great height in the form of a very tall trunk, which spread itself out at the top into a manner of branches. Occasioned either by a sudden gust of air that impelled it, the force of which decreased as it advanced upwards, or the cloud itself being pressed back again by its own weight, expanded in the manner described. It appeared sometimes bright and sometimes dark, according to whether it was more or less impregnated with earth and cinders. This type of volcanic event is still known as a Plinian eruption. The ash column can rise to 50 kilometers into the atmosphere, and then the ash can be spread for thousands of kilometers by winds. An eruption can alter weather patterns for months. The force behind the expulsion of the column is the result of gases expanding within the magma as it rises, as the overlying pressure is reduced. A kilometer below the surface, the rising mass loses all coherence. The volcano violently boils over. As for the pyroclastic flow of AD 79, it too reached Pliny the Younger. It traveled across the Bay of Naples, shedding its lethal load and losing strength. By the time it reached the young man, it was little more than a miasma. It dropped the merest layer of fine ash over his sandals. 2. Island. Hawaii is evidently paradise. There are paradise restaurants, paradise realtors, paradise tours, paradise apartments. The Hawaii Star Bulletin modestly describes itself as the pulse of paradise, thereby grafting paradise onto the qualities of a living being. There is a lot of business hanging on Hawaii's paradisiac qualities. When you first approach Waikiki, the resort town on the developed island of Oahu, paradise is not the first comparison that comes to mind. One traffic jam is much like another, and vast hotels vaguely themed on ersatz Polynesian mementos are no vision of life in the Garden of Eden. To be sure, the lawns in front of the hotels are immaculately trimmed, palm trees lean out to greet you, there are even waterfalls tastefully constructed about the entrances, and there is a smile on the lips of every flunky. This is paradise designed for the determined shopper. Armani and Gucci and Tommy Hilfiger outlets line up along the sidewalk, doubtless too in the Paradise Mall, alongside 100 other familiar names to nudge the relaxed holidaymaker with bargains that will seduce them from their cash. The goods are mostly the same as can be bought in London or Rome or Tokyo, a kind of global cornucopia, deceptive in its promise of local idiosyncrasy. Most of the Aloha shirts are made in China. Perhaps the visitor should turn elsewhere to discover paradise. Not far behind Honolulu, mountains rise surprisingly quickly, and they are clothed in forest. There is an easy walk through it to the Manoa Falls north of Waikiki. The little path dodges this way and that through trees, ever upwards, often muddy. This is more like the paradise of the movies. Vast trees soar way above you, and their huge trunks are decked with climbing plants, some of them with enormous leaves, or heart-shaped foliage blotched with yellow patches. These vines seem vaguely familiar from florists' shops, though here they grow on a giant scale. There is an intense and humid odor of prolific growth. You can almost hear the shoots squeezing upwards towards the sun. There are pale yellow spikes of fragrant ginger flowers on either side of the path. Within a few minutes, you are dripping with perspiration, for no breeze disturbs this extravaganza of unfettered growth. Piping noises echo somewhere in the canopy way above. Half-seen birds such as these are obligatory in Eden. When the waterfall is reached at last, some of your fellow walkers cannot resist the urge to wade out among the rounded boulders to catch a fickle spray that has plunged 200 feet down a lava flow. Bathing in a pool in the midst of a primeval jungle is the dream of paradise on the holiday brochure. But this, too, is a bogus paradise. Almost none of the plants that climb up the massive trees along the path are native to Oahu or the Hawaiian Islands. Indeed, neither are the trees themselves. They are interlopers brought to this remote place by humans. These plants settled in the tropics and thrived, displacing much of the native vegetation. The resemblance of the climbers decking the trees to pot plants is no coincidence. Some of them are the same species that can be bought in a supermarket in Norfolk, England, or Plains, Iowa, as commonplace in their way as tomato ketchup. Even the sweet-smelling ginger plant that looks so at home by the pathside is a Johnny-come-lately, an aggressive colonizer. This place is not so much paradise lost as paradise replaced, a paradise of aliens dressed up to look as if they belong. The massive assurance of the trees is play-acting. The Hawaiian Islands were once pristine, as remote from any major continent as anywhere in the world. They were originally colonized by a mere handful of hardy, far-traveled plants and animals, birds, insects, reptiles, that subsequently evolved prolifically in their new Eden. The species that appeared as a consequence were endemics, that is, they were found nowhere else in the world. The islands became a natural evolutionary laboratory. There were several hundred fruit flies found nowhere else, and an array of flightless birds pecked among the underscrub. This is where a caterpillar learned to be a meat-eater. The land snail, Acatinella, evolved 1,000 or more species. The familiar plant Lobelia, blue-flowered mainstay of 1,000 hanging baskets, evolved fantastical tubular flowers that could only be pollinated by even more fantastical birds. Scarlet or yellow honey creepers with bills as narrowly curved as precision surgical tweezers. The Bishop Museum displays glorious ceremonial capes of Hawaiian chiefs fabricated from the feathers of countless honey creepers. They must once have been abundant. These wonderful birds are now, alas, mostly displaced by interlopers, minor birds and doves, with more ordinary dietary requirements. They can feed on the crumbs and scraps left by tourists, where the honey creepers dined solely on nectar. Even the flightless birds had their part to play in the original ecosystem. They ate the fruits of the aboriginal trees, whose seeds could only germinate once they had passed through the avian digestive system. But then the introduction of the mongoose saw to the extermination of the flightless birds. So why introduce the mongoose? These aggressive little predators were brought in deliberately from India to catch rats, themselves another introduction. The rats escaped from ships, doubtless, as they have all over the world. They threatened the sugarcane crop, which of course was yet another introduction, and one which transformed the Polynesian mixed economy of taro cultivation supplemented by fruit and fish into the specialized cosseting of a cash crop. But then the Polynesians themselves had already introduced the breadfruit and several useful species of palms. You begin to wonder at what point paradise first became corrupted. Nowadays, mongooses skitter across the road in front of you when you least expect it, cheekily self-confident. They must have made short work of endemic flightless rails and other birds. But the rats are still there. Mongooses are mostly diurnal, whereas rats are nocturnal. The extermination policy that introduced them was as pointless as proposing to introduce bats in order to eliminate wasps. Both mongooses and rats prospered while the birds disappeared. The few trees that remained from archaic times have no method of reproduction. They have outlived their propagators and have become sad remnants enduring from a vanished paradise. They are not entirely doomed because attempts in the Lion Arboretum to regenerate them from culturing slivers of their living tissue have met with some success. The arboretum where this work goes on is where you might get a hint of what might have been in the original islands, but carefully cultivated, a kind of Garden of Eden reconstituted. You begin to wonder whether you can go anywhere to see the real thing. Hawaii is actually a group of islands, all of them volcanic. The island of Oahu is the one that people tend to imagine represents the typical Hawaii. This is where the hotels and surfing beaches of Waikiki promise counterfeit paradise. Most of the islands, however, are completely different from this urban fantasy. The volcanic activity on Oahu is quiescent. The other main islands are Molokai, Kauai, Niihau, Maui, and the youngest, and by far the largest, known everywhere as the Big Island. Strictly speaking, this island is Hawaii, and it is still actively erupting. This is where you can go to see the world being made. On the rainy side of the Big Island, on one flank of the Volcanoes National Park, there is a remnant of the original forest. This area is several thousand meters above sea level, and the rain is often heavy. In the mornings, a drenching mist can smother the landscape, only to be fried off by the sun before midday. The dominant canopy plant is the ohia, a grayish tree of medium height, often gnarled and dressed with lichens, and carrying small, oval, dark green leaves that shine attractively in a certain light. Early in the day, there is a silvery brilliance in the ohia forest that cannot be matched anywhere else in the world. When in flower, the ohia is called ohia lehua. The flowers look like old-fashioned shaving brushes made of dense red stamens. Several of the remaining honey creepers earn their living from sipping the nectar of their blossoms, and there always do seem to be flowers somewhere in the ohia forest. Around Volcano Village, the understory is composed prominently of tree ferns. The commonest species is the hapu, cibotium, a majestic and graceful fern with all the elegance of a green fountain. There are so many of them, it looks almost as if the earth has sprung a series of verdant spouting leeks. Other herbs and small trees clamber among the ferns, bewildering botanists who try to place them with their more conventional relatives. In this forest, there is at least a chance that the piping you hear is from a native bird. The churring is almost certainly the native cicada. but along the path sides there are already plantains that you recall as weeds from Europe, the scourge of every lawn, and the seductive ginger plant pokes out from the undergrowth. There is trouble already in this paradise. This jungle is simply structured, comprising only a canopy and understory. The ohia trees are not like the dominating and diverse monsters of the Amazonian rainforest, with layer upon layer of tearing beneath them. Yet within these grey woodlands there are hundreds of species unique to the Hawaiian Islands. Then we must add the fact that each island has a windward and a leeward side. Most of the rain falls prolifically on the windward side. The other side is in rain shadow. Clouds throw down what moisture they carry as they climb the mountains, but the further side remains dry. The animals and plants are different again on the dry flanks, tougher in several ways, survivors in the face of hardship. They comprise an entirely distinct community from that of the rainforest. Growing on nearly bare lava flows, the flora includes small relatives of the familiar cranberry. The ohelo carries a bright red succulent berry that was once a staple item in the diet of the nene, the Hawaiian goose. The nene is a handsome bird that almost became extinct in the wild, but was reintroduced successfully from ones bred in captivity. Ohelo berries are pleasantly tart, like watery cranberries, but scarcely the forbidden fruit of paradise. Ritual dictates that you must offer a berry or two to Pele, the fierce goddess of fire, before you eat them yourself. Many of the drought-tolerant species, like the ohelo, are rarities now, too. Because the volcanic mountains rise to great heights, there are some unique species adapted to alpine conditions. The most extraordinary of these is the silver sword, a huge bundle of silvery, blade-like leaves looking something like a crouching, bristling porcupine. It lives high on the bare volcanic slopes at an altitude where little else will grow. It flowers and then dies. The flowering spike arises like some huge columnar firework from the center of the leaf rosette. Close examination reveals that each flower head is little more than a daisy. There are hundreds of these humble purple flowers on each spike. It takes the silver sword 20 years to screw up the energy for its final floral pyrotechnic. This is what Hawaiian isolation has done to one of our most familiar flowers. The remarkable forests with their remarkable animals, the rain shadow plants, the nene, and the hundreds of inconspicuous fruit flies all owe their existence to the geology of the Hawaiian Islands. This is a place where the geology announces itself in everything you see. Only in Honolulu and Waikiki do the works of mankind obscure the works of nature. Save for the star fruit trees in the backyards, the neat suburban roads lined with well-tended villas surrounding these cities might be in almost any small town in Iowa or Michigan. North American domestic vernacular architecture has become the lingua franca of middle-class habitation. On the remoter shores, you may see the open canopy dwellings of the Polynesians. There are very few purebred Hawaiians. On the windward shore of Oahu, these houses are often backed by steep cliffs of dark volcanic lavas. Scratch around almost anywhere, and there will be similar volcanic rock beneath the dirt. The geology dictates the soil. Along the trail to Manoa Falls, this rock weathers to something with the color and consistency of gingerbread. It can be ground to crumbs in your hand. Constant tropical rain makes a mush of hard old lavas. The end product is a brick-red soil called laterite. Its color comes from all the iron in the oxidized or ferric state it contains, its other important element being aluminium. Laterite soil is not suited to growing many crops, but sugar likes it. The great cane fields of Hawaii used to occupy much of the lower ground, at least from the 19th century onwards. Feral canes are still everywhere. To a European, they look like hugely overgrown leeks. The bottom fell out of the market during the Reagan era, and now the great mills stand idle, and some of the fields are reverting to scrub. Others have been taken over by pineapple plantations. in the saddle or valley between the huge extinct volcanoes on Oahu, the dole plantations stretch for mile after mile along Route 99. The pineapple was once considered so exotic that it became a symbol of wealth to the aristocracy who alone could afford it. Pineapples sculpted in limestone often adorn the gates of stately homes in England. It comes as something of a disappointment to see huge pineapple fields so relentlessly uniform in ranks of green rosettes. You expect to see trees as exotic as the fruit itself. Isolation created the opportunities for the species to evolve that made the original paradise. The islands all grew as volcanoes from the seafloor over the last 5 million years or so. The Big Island is still growing. 20 miles off the southeast coast of this island, there is an active volcano still hidden beneath the sea. The Lo'ihi Seamount is steadily erupting, and one day it too will break above the waves and a new land will be born. Within a year or two, the first pioneer plant species will arrive to colonize the bare lava, their seeds perhaps being carried on the feet of a passing booby. The process of evolution will happen all over again. This insular birth is supposed to occur in 50,000 years or so, a geological tomorrow. The Hawaiian Islands provide an opportunity to see the birth, maturity, and death of a landscape. Creation is here, so too is massive erosion, and it has all happened in a timescale of just a few million years, a span that we can begin to understand. The Polynesian peoples arrived by boat for the first time about AD 500, but a second wave of immigration from Tahiti was more or less contemporaneous with the Norman conquest of England in 1066. The evolution of the web of interrelated island endemic species took thousands of times longer, time enough for some species of birds to lose the capacity for flight and for others to develop long curved bills. Think of what has happened in the 1,000 years since the Norman conquest. All the advances and reverses and complexities of history, the technological revolutions, the rise and fall of empires. It then seems less astonishing that a complete and distinct biology should arise in a span of more than 50,000-fold again. The Big Island is the most southerly island of the group, and near its southern side you can witness the genesis of new crust. Lava has erupted from Kilauea for hundreds of years. Occasionally it blasts out in major eruptions, hurling volcanic bombs hundreds of feet into the air. Mostly, however, the eruption is comparatively benign by volcanic standards. The kind of basaltic lava that has built Hawaii is highly fluid and charged with gas. It flows rather than explodes. A new lava flow cannot be entirely stopped, but it can be outrun if your house is about to be engulfed. The flow of 1992 to 1997 blocks the coastal road that used to run southwards from the town of Hilo. It simply truncates the paved surface at right angles, abruptly. From one side, it looks as if a gigantic load of tar had been dumped by a disgruntled contractor. The road disappears beneath the flow, and sure enough, if you walk to the far side of the flow, a few miles along the coast, the road emerges on the other side, apparently unscathed. But the surface of the flow is hard to walk over, being a mass of black and twisted lava. Sometimes it is only too clear that it has cooled from a sticky liquid. Braided curtains or wrinkled sheets of shiny, tarry lava heave and plunge under your feet. The texture of the surface is often described as ropey, and it is an apt description to anyone who has seen tangled masses of ropes on the side of a harbor. On steeper slopes, twisted clots of entrails come to mind. It is astonishing to stand in the midst of a huge lava field with the undulating masses of volcanic material stretching away as far as you can see, for this is a fresh-made world. You are permitted to inspect the current eruption from a safe distance. Parts of the old road have recently been revived, and you can drive very carefully and very slowly over graded parts of recent flows to get near to where the lava still debouches into the sea, Steam plumes, visible from miles away, rise continuously at the meeting between the new crust and the eternal waves, and there is a fierce hiss at the boiling junction. The stench of sulphur is everywhere, sharp in the back of your throat. If this is the breath of the deep earth, then it is poison. You must watch where you step over the recently cooled lava flows, for there are areas where the surfaces have heaved into cracked slabs, as if a vast tarmacadam airfield had been bombed almost to oblivion. It is easy to twist an ankle. On humid days, water vapor combines with the sulfurous emanations to produce an acrid mist known as vog. As dusk falls, the brightness of the living lava becomes more evident. The warm red glow at the sea's edge has a brilliant orange heart. Then you witness an explosion where the combination of violent boiling, sudden cooling, and expulsion of gas result in luminous chunks, one might be the size of a pumpkin, rolling up into the miasma of steam. Fireworks almost, but more inexorable. For the moment, the lava wins against the ocean, but one day the balance will be reversed. Now it is dark, you can see other brilliant lights along the flanks of the landward slope. They form a line. It is easy to deduce that this line marks the current course of the flow. It is not at the surface, but flows in a conduit, a lava tube, a short distance under the inky wasteland. You can trace the lights to the vent itself, at Pu'u'o'o, on the flanks of the older Kilauea caldera. After the initial eruption from the new vent, the crust on top of the lava flow solidified, but the flow continued unabated beneath the skin covering over the tube. It is like an artery continuously bleeding the red blood of the earth. In places, the roof of the tube has crumbled away, and the lights on the hillside trace these windows giving into the streaming inferno beneath, glowing bright orange. There is a lucrative local trade in lava photography, and many Hawaiian photographers like to crawl close to the windows and record the streams of magma and the fountains of fire that splatter up from time to time. But there are dangers. Where the lava hits the sea, it often builds out into an unstable platform. Only a few years ago, two overconfident visitors were killed when the platform broke away into the violent and boiling sea. The process of creation is not merely dramatic, it can be lethal. In the Volcanoes National Park, you can walk inside a lava tube, which has long since voided its last molten load. The Thurston lava tube now lies in the rainforest, and tree ferns decorate its entrance. It had a curiously familiar feel to me, and it was some minutes before I realized that this was because it had the exact dimensions of that other tube, the Piccadilly Line tunnel in London, on which I travel virtually every day. It is indeed almost perfectly tubular. The walls are curiously smooth. There is nothing here to produce the stalagmites that adorn caves in Kentucky or Cheddar. Part of the tube has been illuminated, but you are permitted to go on into the darkness at your own risk. It is a strange sensation to creep by flashlight into the guts of a former eruption, and just for a moment you might wonder if that rushing sound might be something other than the wind in the ohia trees. But the dimensions of the tube do give you a very good idea of how much lava can be transported in an eruptive phase. By measuring the velocity of a flow, it is easy to calculate the volume of an eruption. On the present eruption at Pu'u'o'o, flow velocity is measured using radar through the skylights. Since 1983, 300,000 cubic meters per day have been flowing down towards the sea. Creation can be calibrated. The eruptions happening now are as nothing compared with those of the recent past. The Kilauea caldera remains as a testament to this activity. It is huge, 4 miles, 6.4 kilometers across. You come across it almost unawares, driving through the lush ohia forest. Suddenly, the colossal whole of Kilauea Iki is before you, and you have glimpsed a different world. It is as if some irresistible force had pulled an enormous bung or plug out of the earth. Far below, the congealed lava in the crater still smokes from cracks in its surface. The whole pit is so clear of vegetation and so regular that for a moment you wonder whether such a structure might be man-made. It has been cauterized clean, and surely only human labor could carry out such an efficient scrubbing job. Then you can visualize that beneath the crusty surface there is still liquid rock lying low. It somehow looks as if it had only recently finished cooking. Kilauea Iki erupted as recently as 1959, and there was a major flow from elsewhere on Kilauea in September 1982. The whole place is not exactly sleeping, more pausing for a moment in the middle of a bad dream. When the Volcano House Hotel was opened in the 19th century, the visitor could look down at boiling magma pools from the balcony while sipping a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.